It's a pleasure for me to welcome Professor Jiří Jaromír Klemeš at the Technical University of Košice. The lecture titled Energy, Water and Environmental Footprint Interaction, Sustainability Implication for the Major Economy Sector of Europe and Worldwide is held as invited lecture within the project Reindustrialization of Europe and European Union 2016. At first, we will receive some information about this project through video recording. Prosím o video.
Integration and Optimization, edited handbook
of process integration and handbook of water and energy management in food processing. Professor Klemeš is the editor-in-chief of chemical engineering transaction indexed in the database Scopus, subject editor of energy and editor-in-chief of the Journal of Cleaner Production, regional editor for Europe for Applied Thermal Engineering and Cleaner Technologies and Environmental Policies. He is also the editor of Resources, Conservation and Recycling, Theoretical Foundation of Chemical Engineering and Other Impact Journal. He is the chair of Computer Edit Process Engineering of European Federation of Chemical Engineering. I am very pleased that Professor Klemeš has been accepted our invitation to lecture at our university. Now it's time for the lecture. Professor Klemeš, stay on board, please.
Good morning, everybody. I'm sorry, I can use some other languages for the lecturing, but if you like it or not, English is the language of the technology. And even on, if on my UK driving license is written born in Czechoslovakia, I spent the vast majority of my working career in the UK, and this is the language which I generally use for lecturing. Well, about 2 weeks ago I got a tough task because I was lecturing in Kazakhstan, and after first lecture they said, okay, it's nice, but can you continue in Russian? Well, I can, but lecture in Russian 8 hours a day, it's not easy. So let's stick with English, and I am happy to be here because I am here again after approximately 50 years. The last time I was in Košice, I was about your age, and many things changed from that time. Unfortunately, one of those which changed is the time and my age. I am not longer anymore, and as a result of it, as you can see, the CV is long and boring. But you know, this is what is happening, and I would like to spend about, say, 60 minutes to telling you some experiences which I gained. So the first, as I said, I was born in Czechoslovakia. I am not Czech, I am Moravian. You know, it's like England and Scotland. We are living in the same state, but we don't like very much those people in Prague. I'm quite close to Slovakia, being in Moravia. But I was lucky enough in 1968 to get the scholarship, and I actually left Czechoslovakia on the 20th of August evening, and when I came first time to Cambridge University, you know, the dean invited me to his office and bore a very nice measure of scotch and said, I've got a bad news for you. I said, what? What could happen? He said, you know, the Russian tanks are in Prague. And so it was the start of my career in the UK. I was lucky enough to do most part of my PhD at Leeds University. At that time it has been one of the best. And after I spent some time in Edinburgh, Scotland, which is a beautiful city, probably one of the most beautiful cities in the world, if it's not winter. In the winter it's one of the most beautiful cities in the world at night, because the day is there about 1-2 hours. And finally I moved for about 20 years to Manchester, and stayed there. We did quite a successful research. I was involved as being told not in 80, now it reached 90 European and other projects, because if you know once how to do it, you've got better chance. And when I reached a reasonable age which allows you to retire, I got Marie Curie Chair of Excellence and decided that a nice country to spend some time is Hungary. Much better by weather, food, the second half of the mankind, to say politically correctly. So I spent now already 10 years in Hungary. So this is my short professional movement. And everything started at UMIST, University of Manchester Institute of Science and Technology, which used to be a marvelous university. I loved it. We've been always amongst top 10 in the league. Unfortunately, in year 2004, it was decided to merge it with the University of Manchester. And you know, this is something like if you merge Ferrari with Fiat. Fiat is mass production, Ferrari is achievement and performance. But actually Fiat did it okay, because nowadays Ferrari is owned by Fiat, but they still keep the trademark. Unfortunately, the University of Manchester didn't. And as a result, I was very happy to move to West Brem, and nowadays to Budapest. So, this is the present university, Pázmány Péter Catholic University. You know, it looks, I'm not a very religious person, but there are not, even when it's Catholic University, they are now interested very much in research. Interesting is that this university was founded 1635, and guess where? In Nitra, in Slovakia. It is the same like Hungarian Academy of Sciences was founded in Bratislava. So I'm sometimes joking that most of Hungarian science and research originates from Slovakia. Well, at that time it was a part of Hungarian monarchy, but what is nowadays Hungary was mostly occupied by Turks, Ottomans, so everything was there. And this university is not state, which is a big advantage. It has got much better working conditions, and the head of it is at the moment Papa Francisco. And I'm very proud to get professorial certificate signed by the Pope. This, you know, normally, previously I got it from Hungarian president. In the UK, you haven't got it from anybody. Professorship is a matter of the university. And this is my research group. And as you can see, it's fairly multinational. And this is what I inherited from UMIST. If you look on the top on co-supervisors, they've got one thing in common. Not the religion, not the race, but all of them had something in common with UMIST. They either been members of academic staff or PhD students. And those alumni, it's enormous power, because whenever I go around the world, we've got some former students. And this is one thing which I'm recommending to each university I'm visiting. The more international you've got students, especially doctorate students, the better. Because it makes the university being known, promoted, and also it's you know, a little bit like if you marry inside a family, as Habsburgs did. You know, the children are not genius. And many of famous people actually had parents from very, very remote part of the world. And with the research is something similar. At UMIST we had in the group 36 different nationalities. And when we appointed even new member of staff, we always look for somebody who hasn't been represented. So this group has got Malaysians, Chinese, Italians, even Hungarians, Slovenians. You can see some Muslim women, which in the Czech Republic now it's a strong feeling that Muslim population is something what is dangerous. I can tell you it's like everywhere. They are well-educated Muslims, but unfortunately they would never come illegally. They always come legally and they follow the rules. But we've got also our population which is not very legal. And this is my favorite journal, Journal of Cleaner Production. And I become co-editor-in-chief. And this is really a task. I'm happy that we accepted also a paper from this university. We've got a rejection rate about 85%. It means that only 15% of papers are accepted. And it's no other way to do it. If you want to keep impact factor close to 5 or more, and if you've got entry for the journal, this year already we've got 6,000 papers. And from 6,000 papers, we have to select very carefully. And those are the most cited papers, which is a kind of the benchmark. Of course, most cited are always reviews. If you want to get something for your career, I don't know how it is here. In Hungary, you have to have minimum as a doctorate student, as a PhD student, 2 papers with minimum impact factor 1. If you are in Southeast Asia, it's a little bit tougher. In China, to get MSc, student has to get 4 papers. And for doctorate, they've got it by impact factor. So the student has to publish the papers with impact factor in the sum minimum 12. And this is quite tough. Okay, this is why cleaner production is popular, because you can score very highly. I don't like impact factor too much, because this is something administrative and it doesn't tell you too much about, it can say about popularity, but as I said, the review is always much more popular. And if you publish something brand new, which not too many people understand what it's about, you might not to get enough citations. But unfortunately, the world is like this. In China, students, if they published in our journal, they've got nearly 5,000 yuan renminbi premium, which is some reasonable money. If they published this journal of 1, they've got 1,000. But they've got the big incentives and they are working enormously hard. This is my Google Scholar. If you haven't got it, I recommend everybody to get profiles in Google Scholar, Scopus, and the Web of Science or Web of Knowledge. Google Scholar has got one advantage. It's very fast. If you've got citation yesterday, it's in. This is already not valid because the numbers went up during yesterday when I was traveling. The problem is a weak point. You have to clean your profile. I am very lucky because my name is very rare. But if your name is Smith, Brown, Lee, Liu, Zhang, Wang, or Johansson, this is in our Czech, is Novak, Svoboda, it's a problem. And you need to spend the time to clean your profile and to keep only yours. So, you know, there are some set examples when somebody is called Smith and has got 20,000 citations, but his own are about 5. And also you have to be careful because Google Scholar, because Google Scholar is taking everything. So it can be even not scientific publication. But if you are spending some time on it, it's fine, and it's very good. And you can also, on the right-hand side, you've got your co-authors, which is also quite good. And it created for the citation some kind of a cluster, and it increases citation. So, enough introduction, and now what I'm going to talk today about. We've got increasing world population, and if you like it or not, it is happening. And some countries, like China, decided to control it in a very tight way. Now they realize that just one child is a little bit too tough, so now in China you can get two children under some conditions. So China is more or less not growing in uncontrolled way, but there are some countries which are. And India is already overtaking China, not by development, not by technology, but number of people. And especially in Asia, there are very populous nations. And when I made the statistics and came there, I was surprised because Indonesia, quarter of billion, 250 million people, probably already more, maybe 260. Vietnam, 100 million, Philippines, more than 100 million, and so on. And all those people obviously would like to get better life. And better life means more resources, more energy, and more water. So, where to get it? Energy, we know a lot about it. We've got fossil fuels, we've got renewables, and we've got also a lot of wars. Because if you look on the map, where are military conflicts, they more or less agree with the sources of fuel. And you know, on one side, we are saying, unfortunately, in the Central Europe, Visegrad and so on, we are not lucky with resources. But if you've got a lot of fuel, it's always somebody who would like to improve, in quotes, your human rights and liberate you and beside take your resources. But it's not only energy, it's also water. And water is becoming more and more curtailed source. In our countries we consider this not a big problem, but of course there are countries like the Gulf, Saudi, Kuwait, Bahrain, but there are some other. For example, Beijing just commissioned a huge desalination plant, about 50,000 tons a day of water, just to supply Beijing, because the rivers which they are not able to do it. So it another problem. What we can do with this? Well, the first thing, and I will talk about it, and sustainability, is to use resources in very wise way, not to waste it. And unfortunately, we are wasting a lot. I've got an example about the water in my hometown when I was born, and I still got the house and the relatives. The water 30 years ago cost nothing. In nowadays expression sense, that time hellers. And it wasn't enough. It was needed to build new capacities. Nowadays we've got fairly expensive water. It's about 10 euros per cubic meter. So You know, if you calculate it, even to flush the toilet costs something. And if you've got a leaking tub, it's a lot. And suddenly, the consumption of water is lower by 30%. So it is possible to do it, but it has to be some incentive. And you can also use, and this is what I'm doing in my professional research, it's called total site. It means to use the waste heat and waste power, waste electricity from one plant or source of energy and use it for another. So this is what we should do. Well, suggestions we should try to integrate industrial plants, we should try to integrate smaller industrial, civic, residential business, and even agriculture complexes. And this has been developed into methodology in some parts of the world. Austrians are trying to do self-sustainable regions. It means the region which is not importing any fuel. Well, they are very proud of it, but it's not possible to do it everywhere. It's possible to do it in Austria, where you've got a lot of hydroelectricity. Okay, they supply it with biomass and other things, but very, very rarely you can do it when you haven't got a big source of renewable energy. The problem is our emissions are growing. Are growing very, very fast, and beside all of those conferences, you know, you were at Kyoto, Lisbon, Paris, whatever, they are not going to be lower. And what is the problem? The problem is the most dirty fuel in this case is coal. And coal is cheap, and two largest economies in the world, which is the US and China, they've got plenty of cheap coal and they are using it. You can blame them, you can say you are poisoning the planet. But money matters. If we like it or not, money matters. And you can see here the forecast for another number of years, and it looks that the coal still will be the king. So let's have a look what are those emissions. Everybody is talking nowadays in media about carbon-free society. Carbon-free society is a nonsense, because we are not going to reduce carbon. Carbon is everywhere. Carbon is sea, it's in our body. You've got the steel on the chair where you sit. You've got it everywhere. Well, it should be, but this is media talk, it should be CO2. But on this graph you can see that CO2 is actually responsible for less than 2/3 of so-called greenhouse gas emissions. Greenhouse is an English word for something what we in Central European languages called glass house. It's what we've got in the garden to increase the temperature and get better vegetables and better products. And unfortunately, there are some gases which are here, CO2, NOxes, methane, and some others, fluorinated gases, which fortunately are only those who have been reduced because we prohibited to use them in fridges. So those are all gases which should be reduced. And talking about this, it's an interesting issue about what is the world dirtiest country by greenhouse gas emissions per person. What do you think? What is the world dirtiest country? any idea. Well, you should always have idea, because if you have no idea, you are 100% wrong. If you try, you've got always the chance to succeed. So, any suggestions? The most polluting country in the world per person.
China.
Wrong. New Zealand. Per person, not absolutely. And do you know why? New Zealand, they've got 4.5 million people and they've got 200 plus million of sheep, cows and animals. And what those animals are doing? Well, they are breathing, which all of us do, but they also produce a lot of methane. How? Because especially cow has got several stomachs. And what is coming finally out is called excrements, and they are huge, and in this is a coming chemical process called anaerobic digestion, which is producing a lot of CH4 methane. In Europe, the dirtiest country per person is Switzerland. Again, you wouldn't think about it, but the reason is the same. China is a huge polluter, but it's divided by about 1.6 billion people. This is how it goes on the Earth. This is the Earth's energy balance. And this is telling you what are greenhouse gases. I put always down here the source. If you are interested to get more information, you can go on the source and find it. What is happening our planet, which is actually the shape is not the ball, it's something like an egg. No, it's so big, but it is an egg. And this is the reason why we've got four seasons, why we've got summer, autumn, winter, and spring, because it has got the axis slanted, plus it's an X, so it's changing. But what is happening here is we've got the energy coming from the sun, which is this yellow one, but not all is coming to the surface, as you can see from the using the number about 340. Finally, it arrives and it's absorbed by the surface about 166. And some of this is reflected by clouds' atmosphere, by surface. But to keep it in the balance, we've got also loss of heat. And this is this surface radiation, which is this one. And if we have no greenhouse gases, everything would go out, and what would happen? Our planet would be something close to the moon, with temperatures minus 40, minus 50, and we would have no life. So greenhouse gases acts like a mirror. From one side, it allows the heat to come, but going out, it reflects it back. So greenhouse gases are actually good, but they shouldn't be changed by the huge quantity, because this is the balance of the temperatures which developed on this planet over millions of years and which is comfortable for our living. But it has been changing over centuries. It's been ice periods when we've got in Central Europe icebergs and vice versa. What is the problem? This is so-called carbon or better carbon emission cycles. Everything has been here for a long time, you know, going like this, but we introduced this part. And we introduced industry and we introduced agriculture. And at the beginning it was no big problem, but last 50 years it has been everything developing enormously fast. And this is the problem because we can disbalance the heat balance. And in this case, if temperatures are going up, what would happen? We would have more clouds. And clouds are actually the most intensive greenhouse gas. And if we finally got the whole planet covered by clouds, it can't be point of no return. Temperatures would go up, up, up. There are some planets like Venus, which went through this period. It's not water, there are some other chemicals, but they overheated. Now, if I said we should save energy, this is a little bit light, an amusing picture. What we should do to consume the minimum energy for the transport. As you can see, the most environmentally friendly is to use bike, but preferably not a racing bike, because we would have about 15 kilocalories per kilometer. But as a granny, grandma going for the shopping in the village slowly, this is the best. Walking is still okay, but consuming more. Small motorcycles are not too bad. By the way, in China, they prohibited to use mopeds and small motorcycles burning fuel. All of them must be electrical, and they are. Trying trains. The train is, like all public transport, a little bit interesting. Because if you've got a train with one or two passengers, it's enormous waste of energy. If you've got a train packed with several hundreds, it's very environmentally friendly. So this is what sometimes transport companies are using, saying, okay, you know, we are doing the best for the environment if the trains and buses are overcrowded. Well, but we don't like it, but this is the case. And if you see the car is a big difference if you've got a car with five people and just the driver. And it went so far that in some places, like Singapore, and now South Korea and China, they are making restrictions. If you want to enter city center, and you are just a driver, you have either to pay a lot or to wait and invite somebody to go with you. And it's happening in Singapore, you know, on the border of the city. This is a parking place and people are offering you the lift, which is quite pleasant and environmentally friendly. And in some other places, they've got different lanes. They've got a lane for just one person, two, three, four, five. And of course, usually this for one person is overcrowded. And if you've got five people, you can choose wherever you want. So those are ways how to save energy. But what is the most important are energy losses. And this is actually a horrifying picture. This is from a reputable website and shows you US balance of the energy. On the left hand side you've got inputs, and this is what we don't like too much, you know, huge amount, half of this is coal. Not too much are renewables, about 10%, but on the other side, the yellow is what we can use, but the red is what we are losing. And I pick up US because it's an advanced economy. Some developing countries got losses much, much larger, 80%, 90%. But even US is losing by transformation and transmission more than two-thirds of the energy. So why we don't see this in media, why we don't see this international treaties. Because if we reduce the losses by half, we wouldn't need most of the coal, and it's actually much more than renewables. Well, the problem is nowadays society is the market society, and it runs by produce, sell. And it's much better to produce more and sell more than save. And you know, if you are a person dealing with sustainability, we are not very happy with this, but what to do? There are some, and governments are trying to put some incentives, but they usually put more taxes on everything, and it's not about sustainability, it's about to get higher taxation. This is how it looks like if we've got 100 units of energy from coal. Well, if we've got this old bulb, it's just 2 units. Used. This is why European Union prohibited to use the bulbs, but you know, the market people are very innovative, so they are selling now bulbs not as a lighting device, but as a heating device, which actually is, it's a heating device. Okay, if we've got LEDs or low energy lights, this is not such a big loss, but still we haven't got more than 20 units from this 100 in the coal. So the most environmentally friendly is energy not used, saved, because it has got no emissions, but unfortunately it doesn't go hand in hand with the market economy, because it's much better to produce something for the profit. So how we can achieve some energy conservation? And here we are coming to my research, but don't worry, I will not spend too much on it. It's called process heat integration, and it's been developed in relation with energy crisis in 1970. This is a definition of International Energy Agency, if you read it, but as you can find easily, this International Energy Agency is in Paris, and this sentence is in English words, but it's not very much English, because English sentence never should have more than 3 lines. This is actually French. And it works like this. It's based on something called pinch methodology, when we've got a complicated flow sheet. This is a representation of a chemical, petrochemical, sugar, pulp and paper, steel plant, and everything possible. And you can convert it into 2 curves, hot and cold composite curve. And what is the beauty? If you've got it in the right place, you can read here the minimum heating and minimum cooling which you need. No need for mixed integer nonlinear optimization and other things. This has been widely used and it works in the industry. Just last week I was in Manchester where we've got the 33rd Research Consortium meeting. And those are some companies which are actually happy to pay each £20,000 to be the member and get the research results. And they are not all, but you can see there are free to pay next year and to stay and get the research result and software, or just to leave. And by staying, they are actually voting that this is good for something. And it has been extended even more, as I said, to industrial total sites. And the idea is that some processes has got surplus of heat, waste of heat, which can be used for other processes. And typical total site when it started was oil refinery, which has got number of units and huge amount of energy needed. When I did slow enough, for example, we found that for producing the product, they spent 16% of crude oil. And if the refinery has got slow enough at that time at 6 million tons a year, if you see 16%, those are pretty, pretty big numbers of wasted energy and emissions. So nowadays, good refinery has got about 12%, but there are even better below 10. And this is a huge contribution to emissions. But we went even further, and we started to integrate not only industrial plants, but some other units. And our most successful part was integration of Old Trafford in Manchester. Somebody who is interested in the game of football perhaps knows that on Old Trafford is Manchester United football stadium. And this Manchester United football stadium was actually one of unit. Why? Because it has got its own source of energy, because they must have backup. If they've got 100,000 people on the game and suddenly it's a blackout, it means no electricity, many people would be probably killed in the panic and dark, so they've got a backup. But this backup is 99% of the time unused, so it's a bad investment. So we interconnected it with the nearby shopping center, because shopping center needs energy as well, and it's a huge shopping center, and nearby is also a big hospital and big university, and those are all units which should be integrated. And not only this, we put also renewables in it, as biomass, solar, wind, and some others, and we got very, very good savings with extremely low payback period. Payback period is when you invest in improvement of anything, say, 1 million euros, how long it would take to get it by saving back. So if you save 1 million euro by year, payback period is 1 year. If you save 2 million, it's half a year. And this is what each investor is asking about. You know, what is the payback period? And renewable energy sources are good, but at the moment, with exception of hydro, they've got one big problem: they are expensive. And they are subsidized in all EU countries. And, you know, this question mark if it's good or bad. I don't know very deeply Slovakia, but in the Czech Republic, 3 years ago, it was a big subsidy for the solar energy, and it became a major game ground for, I wouldn't say mafia, but similar people. They were not interested to invest in prostitution and drugs. Solar energy was actually better, because the government promised to buy electricity at very high price for about 15 years. After they tried to cut it down, but you know, renewables can be interesting. Anyway, total site integration can be in many, many different directions. And last two are very much interesting: CHP, combined heat and power. It means when we are producing electricity. In English, power means electricity, which is not always obvious. Electricité is more French, but if we are in Central Europe, we are tempted to use European English, not British, because British people would never say electricity, they would say power. And CHP is to produce at the same time power and heat, and not to waste the heat in cooling towers. If you see cooling towers, this is something badly wrong, because it's a huge wastage of energy and also a huge wastage of water. Why? Because this cloud which comes from those cooling towers, it's actually water steam. And not one ton per hour, there are hundreds and thousands tons for a big power station. And it's loss of water and changing the climate. And the last is desalination, which is coming more and more widespread and consumes a lot of energy. So this should be again integrated with something. If you are interested more in process integration, this is the Bible of it, the handbook, which we published, and I'm quite proud because I managed to persuade more than 30 top researchers around the world to contribute. Sometimes they don't speak to each other because of the competition, but they were happy to accept my invitation. This is about saving. Now about emissions. Emissions, how to measure it? Well, many people, and I've seen research projects, PhD theses, dissertations, and other things. By the way, in English, it's interesting terminology. Dissertation means MSc dissertation, but PhD and big doctorates are always theses. This is different than in Europe. Also, it's different terminology in diploma. If you are going for the job in English-speaking countries, don't put in your CV proudly that you've got diploma. Because at British universities, diploma are for students who failed. Because if you succeeded, you've got degree, and you've got degree certificate. If you just attended and didn't pass exams, you've got diploma. So, you know, there are small things which can make your job application successful or less successful. Anyway, how to quantify emissions? And something that has become very fashionable are footprints. And what is the footprint? In English, it's this one. If we walk and our feet are wet, or if we go through the sand or mud, we are making footprints. And this is used also for emissions. And for the emissions based on life cycle assessment. It means the thesis or dissertation dealing reducing CO2 emission of a boiler or of a furnace or one process are not correct, because life cycle assessment is something from which is quantifying all emissions from the cradle. You know what is cradle? When you've got a baby, nowadays it's not used too much, but from the cradle to the grave, and even better, from the cradle to the cradle, because we should also deal with the waste and ideally to recycle it again. And this is carbon footprint. As you can see, again, it has been on this planet for a long, long time. We've got processes which are releasing CO2, but we've got green plants, and green plants, trees, everything what is green needs for growing CO2. It absorbs CO2, and in that case, we've got a balance. But as we started the Industrial Revolution, we've got this one here, and only with biomass, it was the circuit which worked very well. But all oil and gas has been stored for millions of years. The coal is actually renewable as well. It's a renewable source of energy. Just the problem is that the cycle is about 100 million years. And is the problem if what we stored or nature stored for 100 million years, if we released in a year or 5 years by burning it. So it shouldn't be, it started as carbon footprint, carbon emission footprints, but nowadays right terminology is greenhouse gases footprint. And it started to be used by politicians as well. If you noticed, President Obama and Chairman Xi, two most powerful people in the world. Obama just to the end of this year or beginning of next, but it will be another US president, who knows who. At the moment it doesn't look too good if we see those TV exchanges, but election is something different than after election. So greenhouse gases are having different definitions by footprint, and this is the problem. At the moment we haven't got ISO standards, but usually it goes for the quantities of greenhouse gases to contribute to global warming and climate change by considering specific time horizons about 100 years. I tried with my student to make it also on the land area which is needed of a forest which is capturing the CO2, but the problem is how to make the standard forest, because it can be jungle and it can be something different. This is one of those very threatening pictures. It is the history about CO2, about methane, about NOxes, how they've been growing. And you can see over centuries, it was fluctuating usually by big volcano explosion, but with the start of industrial revolution, it started to go up, and enormously up. Those are the major four. CO2, methane, NOxes, those fluorides are more or less somehow under control, but otherwise it looks very, very bad. And if you work in the area, you are a big pessimist. It will not happen anything within 10, 20 years, but in the horizon 50, 100 years, if business as usual, it can be a real problem. But it's not only carbon footprint, it's also nitrogen. And nitrogen is not considered too much as a greenhouse gas, but it is. It is. And as you can see, it's erased by fossil fuels, but it's also erased by biomass. And this is actually not very good when we started to use a lot of biomass. I will show you an example. This is a big problem because everything what is green, it absorbs NOxes, but when we burn it, this is again released. And this is why European Union now very quietly withdraw the support for biomass, because NOxes are big, big problem. Of course, you can remove it, but in that case, you've got biomass boiler, which is about this size, and NOx capturing and cleaning of gases, which is about 3 times more, consuming energy, consuming chemicals, and costing a lot of money. And this is done on big power stations, but not everywhere. This is, again, not very nice forecast, growing of nitrogen footprint. And here are consequences. You can read it. I don't need to read it by myself because it's faster and I assume most of the audience can read. But it's not only greenhouse gas, but it's a lot of other diseases. And the haze, the smog, which is in big Chinese cities or LA, Los Angeles, it's very much based on NOxes. And NOxes are emitted by agriculture, by burning biomass, but also by diesel engines. And this becomes a huge problem, and it's one of the reasons why probably the electrical car are a must. Because as I said, in China, small motorbikes must be now electrical. If you are in Beijing and would you like to register your car, you can wait 3, 4, 5 years. Because Beijing allows registration every month only 20,000 cars. Well, for Košice 20,000 cars it looks a lot, but not for Beijing, which now has got 38 million. But if you've got electrical car, you can get it registered immediately. And it's a big incentive, you know, people are always listening money. But we've got also water footprints. And water, well, we only realize the problem of water when we haven't got enough. And this is the picture of this field, which is unfortunately coming more and more common. But this water footprint is not as easy. We've got several water footprints. Blue, which is obviously blue water surface ground. Green, coming from the rain. And gray, which is the result of our activities, which is usually brownish gray. And we should do something with this. This is interesting, and it looks too big when you look on it first. It's amount of virtual water what you need from the beginning to the end. And if you look for a cup of the tea, why 35 liters? Well, the tea bush has to grow and be watered. It has to be picked up, processed, transported, boiled, finally you need the water for the cup, you need some water for making the cup, okay, it's divided by number of use, but if you've got one disposable cup, this is not very environmentally friendly, and it's not the end by life cycle assessment, because when we drink the tea, well, we've got effluents, we are producing urine. It should be also treated, and this is the end of the cycle. So, how much is the water footprint of a cup of coffee, if you look on this? It's actually quite high. It's about average 140 liters for cup and coffee. And it's also one interesting issue. Everything what comes through animals, like milk, has got much higher water footprint because we need to keep the animal. But also energy. Energy also requires water. And it doesn't look too much, but crude oil has got about a cubic meter per gigajoule. And if you are going to megajoules and gigajoules, it's quite a lot. Those are CO2 emissions by parts of the world. As you can see, Europe is more or less declining, but Europe is unfortunately declining in everything. In population, in industrial production, in science and research, I, as the editor of the journal, if I look on the number of papers which are coming, about half, more than half, is from China. US is now suffering a big decline. Number of papers in US is going down. Europe is going down. and some other parts of the world, mainly Asian, are growing. And it's the same with everything. So you can see this red going up. And this is the same with water footprint. And this is one chapter about water footprint. If you are able to survive another 20 minutes, I've got something which is in the title, how it really looks with emissions per different countries and different parts of the world. And it starts, the story starts with globalization. We are now living in the global world. And you can get for breakfast, orange juice, kiwi, which is fine. But you can come also to a posh restaurant, not only in Central Europe, but somewhere in America or Asia. And you can get Perrier mineral water, which is environmentally not very fine. You can get butter from New Zealand. So, you know, the business goes around the world, and why? Because the cheapest is always best for the trade and maximizes the profit. And this is how it looks like when you see those huge ships and everything transporting. And to quantify it, one of my PhD students tried to make a study. And this is how it develops the trade balance. Who are the exporting and importing countries? As you can see, China is obviously the most exporting. Russian Federation, why Russian Federation? Well, they are exporting gas and oil. So this is export as well. But the US is a huge importer. And when we would like to be the fair to each country, we should consider greenhouse gas not emitted by the country, but emitted by the consumption. And this is an equation, consumption-based national greenhouse gas emissions, which are those for domestic products minus those which are exported, plus those that are imported. And if you look here, suddenly you've got a quite different picture. China is still the largest polluter, but by consumption based, it's more or less the same as the US. And the importing and exporting countries. And the most importing countries are US and European Union. So by emissions, we are not really fair. We are saying we are doing a lot for the environment, but we are buying a lot of products, and we are buying especially the products which are very energy and water intensive. I've been last year lecturing for BASF directors. This is why I'm sad, because they got yesterday big explosion in Ludwigshafen. And you can see it can happen even in the best run chemical plants. Anyway, they removed most of fertilizers. Probably this which exploded was the last plant. And I said, BASF was originally dyestuff, colors, and fertilizers company. Why? What happened? They said, the European Union imposed strict limits, so we are producing it outside the European Union. And we are doing money on high-value chemicals, which are chemicals used for microelectronics. You know, when you are making chips, you need super clean chemicals and some others. So we are actually trying to push our polluting production out of the European Union and buy it, but you know, it's kind of cheating, because those CO2 and greenhouse gases, if they are produced in China or in Germany, they are still on the same planet. This is an interesting website. You can go on it and you can see live power, the balance of the UK national gas. And it's interesting to see that renewables are, you know, not too much gas. I think coal, steel, this is energy storage, but also import and some others. And wind, which you can see a lot of farms offshore in the sea. Still, it's making about 5% only. The wind turbine has got so-called availability. It means the percentage of the time when it produced electricity, only less than one third. Doesn't look like this, but wind turbine for better number of hours per year is producing only one third. Too little or too strong. And in the sea, the strong wind is the major problem. When wind, they need to park the turbine, otherwise it will be destroyed. So this is the real this is quite a perspective. One of the cleanest fuels by emissions, but it has got a huge losses. Why huge losses? Because to transport the gas, we can do it by pipeline. Pipeline costs a huge amount of money, and make it from Saudi Arabia, it would be the problem. So it's lignified. Lignified means under big pressure and very low temperature, about -110, it becomes liquid, it's put on the ship, transported after evaporated and distributed. And again, the losses are enormous. So it's nice fuel, but by life cycle assessment, it has to be transported a lot. So those are energy sources for CO2 reduction, and as I said, energy efficiency and savings are the best. This is a quick overview of some opportunities. Micro-CHP, Stirling engine and fuel cells, can be quite good, but unfortunately, fuel cells, I am in the business long enough, I've got forecasts in 1970 saying in 10 years we will run most of the transport on fuel cells and hydrogen. After it moved 80, 2000, and it's not happening. If all those money which were actually wasted on fuel cells were put on something, it would be better. Biomass, as I said, biomass has got one, it's the oldest of energy on the because the vast majority of mankind use food for heating. But it still has got a footprint. And it can be because of anoxes, it can be we need to plant the tree, to cut the tree, to produce pellets, to transport it to the station, we've got the ash, so it goes from 25 to 35. And this is an example if you use the different biomass, sometimes people are quite strange. I was in Rotterdam, and this is the table from it. They shown very proudly a biomass-fired power station, and I asked where those pellets, you know, those small parts are coming from, and they said, okay, this is coming from Siberia, and it comes from Vancouver, all the way through Panama Canal up to Rotterdam. Well, the footprint, it's not for free, and footprint is quite a lot. Solar looks quite good, but it very much depends where it is. In the UK conditions, it can be actually worse or on the level from natural gas. I will show you where it works better, but solar panels got actually negative footprint if they are in good sunny place only after about 4 years, because we are making emissions for manufacturing it, we are making emissions for transporting and fixing it. But solar panels also needs maintenance. If you got it in the center of the city, after 3 months you've got, like, we need to clean window, you've got, and windows are vertical, solar panel are more horizontal, you've got a layer of grease, and the efficiency goes down by 30-40% after 3 months. Wind, I already talked about it, and this is the table which is showing you the footprints for different sources of energy. If you want to calculate the footprints, you can go on the website, and there are a couple of websites which are for free, but what is not free are the data. And every website is only as good as the data are. What we can do for reduction, we've got a number of opportunities, but one of them is carbon capture and sequestration. It means to capture it and put it underground to the space which was emptied by gas and oil. Well, from the point of life cycle assessment, it's not the end. It's not the grave, it's just the storage. And it's the gift for our grandchildren. Much better is to use geological sequestration to get it into minerals which are able to capture CO2. And this is now quite well-produced direction. Okay, those are emissions of different countries without a trade. And now if we look on export of China and import of China, we've got figures which are also very, very interesting. Those are exports of laptops or notebooks or electronics from China. And as you can see, it's growing enormously. Most of our mobile phones, it doesn't matter if it's Samsung or Apple or whatever, are made in China. And each of them requires some footprints. And this is the balance. One computer went, creates about 425 kilograms of CO2, and more than half comes from China, because China is buying some parts as chips and other things. So about 90 megatons of CO2 came from this, but textile product. Textile product, again, as you can see, year by year from 2000, China is getting more and more, European Union less and less. And textile manufacturing process, it's very energy and water demanding. So, again, if we've got a cotton, we've got a lot of emissions, and most of them are from China. It's about 200 megatons in a year. But steel production, again, steel production, nearly a half is coming from China. I'm sure you are aware what steel requires, how much heat, energy, and water. And again, Chinese are just emitting it and supplying us steel. And the most emitting, as I mentioned, are fertilizers. And fertilizers are something what the modern agriculture can't leave it. We've got plenty of food, mainly because of fertilizers. And If you look on products, production of ammonia, China is producing about the same amount as the rest of the world, and it's growing. And importers, the major importers are India, which is not a surprise, because they need to feed up people, and US. And if we look on the greenhouse gas footprints, again, China is doing a lot. So those are the emissions to greenhouse gases by intensity. And you can see that fertilizers are really the worst one. So what to say? China is actually emitting a lot, which we are preventing. So the balance is not really fair. And now finally, few good and bad examples. As I mentioned about photovoltaics, this is amazing thing which I've seen in Morocco. Those are mirrors, but those mirrors are not classical photovoltaic panels. Why? Because if you put in Sahara classical photovoltaic panels, they tried to do it, it works only under first sandstorm. After, you know, you got nice sand on it, you can't sweep it, because otherwise it happens in Europe sometimes when we've got wind from Sahara, you got it on the car, and if you by hand try to get it out, it's like sandpaper. So they developed this, and those mirrors are actually heating up this pipe. And when comes the sandstorm, they put those mirrors like the umbrella and prevent the fouling. And as I said, this whole plant has got about 580 megawatts. You know, it comes already to the size of a nuclear power station. And it works, and it works very well. And this is what I have been impressed. The technology is from Siemens, but Morocco and Morocco King was brave enough to put money in it to develop enough electricity and green electricity from the country. So this is an excellent example, which we should praise, and this is the bad example, very bad example, fire season in Indonesia. What are Indonesians doing? They are every year during the fire season, when there are not too many rains, they are burning thousands of square kilometers of rainforests. Have you heard about it? World media are not interested in it. Why? Indonesia is 250 million people, and it's better not to be unfriendly with big and again developing power. The main reason is the fire creates fertilizer, and they can put plantation of palm oil. It goes for about 20 years, and after they burn some others. Well, very bad. If you see on the figures how much of CO2 it generates, it's about 3% of global fuel emission, and more carbon than released by Germany in the whole year. A real environmental crime. It exceeds daily emissions of the entire US economy. And again, nobody bothers. I was in Malaysia and Singapore last year, and Kuala Lumpur is about 500 kilometers from Indonesia. But the emissions were so bad that children couldn't come to school. They had to close the schools and declare state of emergency. Finally, Singapore, which was heavily affected, lost the patients and made the error rate. Singaporean Air Force sprayed clouds with some chemicals and created artificial rain, and it was the end. Indonesia was very unhappy, but Singapore has got about five times more jets than the whole Indonesia, so somehow it was. But you know, those are things we should consider. And look around the world, and not rely only on media, because media are very biased, and they pick up some nice stories, but not the real one. So this is how virtual carbon flows in the international trade. You can see those big reds to US and European Union. You can see this one, which is oil and gas. And those are the countries which are producing, and those are the countries which are spending. It is the same with water, but I will not bother you, but I'm leaving the lecture here. You can study in detail. It's the similar with water, because if you are buying the product which needs water for production, you are actually importing virtual water. And there are some countries which are totally living on imported water. One of them is Japan. Japan hasn't got enough water, but buying all products which require a lot of water from the outside. So, conclusions, there are significant greenhouse gas differences between exporting and importing countries. US and EU got high absolute net import of greenhouse gases. China is mainly exporting country. But what we should do? Should we stop global trade? Probably not. But we should be interested what is the greenhouse gas footprint of the product we are buying. Now, last week I seen in the UK, Tesco is putting labels on each product how much carbon footprint was needed. You know, to those people who would like to do something for the environment, to buy products with lower greenhouse gas footprint. But okay, it's nice, but money matters. People are still buying mainly what has got very nice prices. So those are some studies which are showing you, and I will just show you this one quickly. Biodiesel production from rapeseed oil. We see in Europe quite a lot of those plants, and we are saying this is environmentally friendly and reducing CO2. But it's not so much, because if we make the balance and see how many fertilizers, pesticides, lime, diesel, labor we need, and compare it with petroleum, diesel, we can see we are saving about 40% of CO2, but on NOxes, on some NOxes as nitrogen acid, it's 40%, but on some others it comes to 1,000%. So not everything what looks green is really green. And one thing which all of us can help is the food waste. Food waste, the recent study in the UK found that 60% of food from supermarket is wasted. 60%, this is crazy, but if you sometime look in the waste bin, which is not very pleasant, you can see a lot of this. And the food wastage, greenhouse gas footprint, if we put it on the world scale, would be, after China and the US, the third country. So this is what we can do a lot. Problem is, food is too cheap, and we are encouraged to buy. You know, you've got buy two, pay one, always when we buy something bigger, it's cheaper per unit and so on. And this is especially for persons who are running the family, household business, which are in our culture mainly females, to be responsible. It's if we look in our fridges and in our waste bins, we can save a lot of energy. And you know, again, we wouldn't need the nuclear power stations plus renewables if we reduce the food waste. This is so huge that we should do something with this. Plus, one of every nine people is hungry. Many people in the world haven't got enough food, but it's not a good business. And if we decide to eat about half of the meat, we would also very considerably reduce the footprints. Why? Because everything what goes through animals requires a lot of energy, creates a lot of emissions, and a lot of water. I'm not saying to become vegetarians, I'm not, but do we really need to eat such a big steak for our health? Meat is okay, but meat should be consumed reasonably for our health. And in China, they've got a very nice example. I've seen it in the hotel, I need to make the picture. You know, this is a big breakfast hall, when you can, we called it, I don't know why, the Swedish buffet, where you've got tables and you can take what you want. And in this Chinese hotel is nice announcement. Please eat and drink whatever you want, you are most welcome. But what you leave on your plate will be weighted, and you are going to be charged three times more. I think it's not bad, and I would be very happy if it's implemented in our places as well. You know, because we are taking it freely, put it on the plate, and after throw out. So, I'm coming to the end. When you want to read more about this, those are some books which I managed somehow to publish. Interesting, it depends what you are the most interested in, but on the left-hand side is about energy and water, on the right side about sustainability. This is this one, a handbook of water and energy management in food processing. I started with oil refineries and steel and others, but after I found that the food processing is not so huge, but it's everywhere in the world. And you can find it wherever, and you can save a lot. And this is the invitation to our conferences, which are called PRESS, Process Integration Modeling Optimization for Energy Saving and Pollution Reduction. 2015, it was in Borneo, under kind supervision of orangutans, which are very nice animals. And in Borneo, you can see them not in zoo, in the rainforest, you know, on the distance about 20 meters. Just you mustn't argue with them. If they want your mobile phone, it's better to handle it, because otherwise this orangutan has got about 250 kilos and can take it with your arm as well. This year it was in Prague, traditionally, and this is the invitation next year to Tianjin, to China, and this is the place where we expected, and we already got enormous interest, because China is now doing, they realized this is the first step to be reasonably rich, but the second step is to get a reasonable environment. because you can get 5 cars, you can get the house from the gold, but otherwise you would need to walk in a scaphander or breathing mask, and this is the next step which is important for the mankind. So the lecture is over. You are welcome to ask questions. You can do it in Slovak. I have no problem with this. And only if you want to ask questions, because we haven't got a microphone, I ask everybody to come here and say it in the mic. So, thank you.
Ďakujeme veľmi pekne a pozývame publikum, aby teda využilo možnosť a opýtalo sa nejakú zaujímavú otázku k týmto akutným, aktuálnym a témam, ktoré sa týkajú nás všetkých. Ja pribehnem s mikrofónom k vám bližšie.
You know, this is one difference between European students and Chinese students. Chinese students, they consider very important to ask questions, to prove and to put attention on themselves. Sometimes the questions are not really questions, a little bit artificial, but they've got very competitive culture. If you go, say, to Romania, they consider to ask questions is something inappropriate, because it might mean that they don't understand. And USA sometime between, it's also a lot of questions always. So, it's up to you.
Žiadna otázka v publika.
OK, we've got one. Very good.
Ďakujem veľmi pekne. Ja teda využijem, že sa opýtam po slovensky, keď predpokladám, že študenti bude to aj lepšie zrozumiteľné. Ja som z ekonomickej fakulty, takže mňa by zaujímal váš názor na úvahy o možnej spoločnej environmentálnej dani, o ktorej sa už začína hovoriť v Európskej únii. Aký máte na to názor? Bola by to, alebo teda tie úvahy sú o tom, že by to mohla byť spoločná daň, ktorá by plynula do európskeho rozpočtu. Ďakujem veľmi pekne.
Ďakujem moc. Ja odpovím česky. Doufám, že mě budete rozumieť, pretože v Čechách teď mladá generace tvrdí, že jim dělá problémy rozumět slovensky, což já naprosto nechápu. To. No nic, co se týče tady toho, já jsem trošku pesimista. A já jsem pesimista ohledně celé Evropské unie. A je to trošku, že jsem více jak 20krát fungoval jako expert pro Evropskou unii a znám ten mechanismus zevnitř. A bohužel to není příliš optimistický pohled. Nakonec ten Brexit není výsledek toho, že by Britové nechtěli být se, ale že mají plné byrokracie. A tady toto, co říkáte, idea je většinou velice a já bych byl pro to, ale to, když to vidíte, jak jednotlivé státy přistupují k implementaci tady čehokoliv. Od rozpočtu až věci s ochranou životního prostředí. A bohužel všichni lidé a když je někdo představitelem státu, jeho hlavní a jeho se v žádném případě ničeho, ale jeho hlavní problém je, aby byl znovu v dalších volbách. Čili když to vyhovuje, tak chce tady tímto směrem jde. Když by to vzbudilo odpor, tak politikové jako to musí být tak, buď to velice odvážný, Spojených státech, kde bych prezidenta dvakrát a dost, čili ten prezident v tom volebním období má více zvázané dalšími volbami, ale v Evropě to tak moc není. Čili cokoliv se tady v tomto směru udělá, tak se projde a bude se dělat tehdy, když to bude vyhovovat a vyhovovat zejména tomu, aby se zvýšila popularita těch daných představitelů těch států. A ochrana životního prostředí, jak jsem říkal, je věc poměrně náročná finančně a mají o to zájem jenom ty státy, které už jsou na takovém stupni rozvoje, že je zajímá víc životní prostředí, než a koupit si třetí nebo páté auto. A to v Evropě jsou skandinávské země. Je to do značné míry je to Německo, ale ne zase celé Německo, tam jsou různé státy. Holandsko je tady v tomto směru poměrně daleko, ale když se podíváme na jih Evropy, tak dobře, tam Řecko má problémy, Itálie má problémy, Španělsko mají problémy, takže pro ně jsou důležitější jiné věci. A to je jako dost problém. A z tohoto hlediska ta Evropská unie je hodně nesourodá. To je jako když budete bydlet ve velkém činžovním domě a bude tam několik rodin, které jsou velmi bohaté, střední a potom chudé. A teď budete vyžadovat nějaké akce pro ochranu životního prostředí. Od toho, aby se třeba třídili odpady, až po to, aby pokud je tam centrální vytápění, aby se jim neplýtvalo. A dosáhnout toho, aby všechny tyto rodiny fungovaly zodpovědně, je dost problém. A to je totéž v té Unii. Takže všechno je v pořádku, já to podporuji, ale všichni jsme lidé. A když budete ministerský předseda a máte dva roky před volbami a chcete být znovu zvolen, tak pokud je toto opatření, které bude vyžadovat další subvence nebo další peníze z rozpočtu, tak je to hrozně těžké nějakým způsobem na to přistoupit. No, čili to je odpověď a jediná věc, v kterou věřím, je, to je taky důvod třeba těch přednášek, aby si mladá generace uvědomila, co je za těmi emisemi, co je za znečištěním životního prostředí a dělala proto také něco. Ač můžeme dělat vysoce technologické věci, jako žárovky, což je vynikající věc, můžeme mít lepší ledničky, ale plýtvání jídlem, to nám žádná technologie nepomůže, to je v nás. A můžeme mít také auta dneska, které mají spotřebu 4-5 litrů, ale když se podíváte okolo, tak každý chce čtyřkolku, čím větší, tím lepší. A některé jsou rozumné, ale mnohé mají spotřebu 20 litrů. A ti lidé říkají, ano, já chci ochranu životního prostředí, ale nechovají se podle toho. Tak to je trošku delší odpověď, ale moje víceméně filozofie.
Děkuji pěkně za otázku. Ještě další otázka.
Hello.
Okay, just please a little bit more louder.
Okay. When you were talking about solar energy and footprint, because we can use, for example, solar panels for 30 years around, and after that it's waste. Did you somehow connected that waste with footprint? Because you said that like solar energy is good.
Yeah, well, footprints are something that has been developed quite recently. And important issue is to understand that it's not only greenhouse gas footprint, energy footprint, water footprint. It become a little bit of fashion. Many would like to be famous to get the there are about 200 of them. And it's probably important to pick up for each process and each product the appropriate things. Because there are, this is a little bit outside the question, but there are things which are material. It's health footprint, which is expressed, for example, in number of lost days created by employees. So, you know, this is not only about the energy, but it's also about some other, because we can get, we can reduce energy footprint nicely. And maybe in an economic way, but the production might be dangerous for people who are doing it, and it creates a problem with health footprint. We've got also environment footprint, employment footprint, and this is very tricky footprint, because if we introduce a very modern technology, which is nearly automated, we can finish this. It was also one of European Union programs, Factory of the Future, but I had a problem to apply for the project because they wanted a fully automated factory with minimum waste, minimum emissions, but increased employment. So how to do it? You know, this in this case, we don't need suddenly 1,000 workers producing cars because everything is automated. So the development and the future is an interesting issue. If you are good point is if you you can be from very very different branches of research. You can be technologist, you can be from building steel, you can be from the sociology, you can be from the health. Everywhere are footprints. And if you publish something about footprints, you've got at the present time very good chance to be highly cited. So this is the secret. Secret of highly cited paper is to make good research, but make a good research dealing with some buzzwords, with some very hot words which are catching the attention. It's attracting citation is like a supermarket and buying, because you need to get a good product, but you need to get it in the right place, visible, and nicely packed. And again, it's not totally fair, but this is how it works. So I very much recommend, if you are a young junior researcher, to look for footprints and try to make some research in this direction and to publish. You've got a good chance to be successful.
Dobrý. Ja by som sa chcel opýtať, čo sa týka tej stopy. Čo všetko je tam zahrnuté? Od výroby, cez užívanie, až po napríklad recykláciu?
Tak, to je velice dobrá otázka. Ja, když to vysvetlujem, tak používam tady lahvičku vody. A co potřebuji k tomu? Potřebuji k tomu materiál. Tady je materiál je na tu hlavní část, je materiál na zátku a je tady ta nálepka. Čili co tam musím zahrnout je, z čeho je tady tento plast. A většinou je to buď to organické nebo anorganické, když je to organické, tak a se to někde získává většinou nějakým dolováním nebo něčím takovým, čili to tam musím zahrnout. Je tam úprava a je tam transport a většinou je zase transport do nějakého prvního přepracování. Získá se materiál pro ten plast, což jsou většinou granule, pak to jde do výrobny, kde se to nataví, udělají se z toho sklenice. To je první část. Zvláště tady ta zátka, protože to je jiný plast, to je tvrdý plast. A teďka mám tady tu nálepku a už u té zátky jsou tam barvy, takže modrá. Čili musím totéž udělat, odkud získávám tu modrou, od úplného začátku až na to, až se to namíchá tady do toho. Tady mám potisk barevný, takže musím mít tiskárnu, musím mít barvy, musím to nalepit. Teď mám sklenici, musím, další věc je voda. A aby se potkala ta láhev s tou vodou, tak je potřeba transport. Protože málo kdy mám pramen a výrobnu těchto lahviček. Takže toho transportu je tam hrozně moc. Teď, jak jsem řekl, teď to vypíjí, takže jedna větev toho jde a to, co produkujeme z těla, jde to do odpadu. A měli bychom tam zahrnout také, ale nejen materiály, ale stroje a produkci. A ty stroje a produkce, to se dělí počtem těch lahví, které jsou vyrobeny. Takže někdy je to veliké, někdy je to malé. Když je malá série, tak je to veliké. Ta odpadní voda, ta se do toho také musí zahrnout. A teď mám tedy tu prázdnou sklenici. A co s ní? Někdo ji zahodí, což je špatné, anebo se dá do odpadu, nejlépe do vytříděného odpadu. A to je to, co říkám, jako z kolébky do kolébky. Ne do hrobu, protože hrob je, když to odhodím někde v lese, ale když to dám do sběrné nádoby a doveze se to zase do té továrny, tak to se hodí znovu na výrobu. Ale není to zase bez emisí, protože z té sběrné nádoby se to musí otransportovat, se to musí vytřídit. A jsou zajímavé věci, třeba dělali Finové, a rozbor, co se starým papírem. A běžná praxe, kterou si myslíme my, je starý papír do sběru a přepracovat. Jenomže přepracovat starý papír není vůbec jednoduché. Pokud je potištěný tiskařskou černí, tak se k tomu používají louhy, aby se ta tiskařská čern dostala pryč, což je poměrně dost velká zátěž na životní prostředí, plus ten papír se nedá, poněvadž ten pulp a buničina při každém cyklu se sníží, takže z toho pak vznikne něco, co je v pořádku na toaletní papír, poněvadž to má ta vlákna velice, velice krátká, čili nejde to nekonečně. Takže Finové přišli na to, že pro ně je nejlepší, protože mají spoustu lesů a dřeva, tady ten starý papír použít jako hnojivo. Zakopat ho a ne teda příliš, ale tak, jak se u nás zaorává hnoj, tak tam zaorají u nich starý papír, který se, papír se rozloží a jako to, co jde na znečištění životního prostředí, je menší. A také je to proto, že to nemusí nikam transportovat. Finsko je poměrně rozlehlá země a transport je tam velice dlouhý. Pokud je to třeba ten papír někde, kde nemají lesy, nemají zdroje, ničeho a je to sběrné místo s tím přepracováním blízko, tak je lepší to znovu přepracovat i a pokud možno ještě vytřídit tak, aby se třídil papír, který není stiskařskou černí a nemusel se loužit. Čili celá ta věc je poměrně složitá a není dobré dělat závěry bez toho, aby se udělala analýza. Udělat dobrou life cycle assessment, analýzu životního cyklu, a je práce na doktorskou práci, pokud to chcete opravdu udělat se všemi těmi důsledky, které jdou do a ven. A na druhé straně to je velmi zajímavý, protože já tomu říkám, to je jako crime investigation, jako detektivní práce, poněvadž musí člověk jít, když mám tady tuto láhev, tak se musím podívat, je to láhev, která se vyrábí v Košicích, nebo se vyrábí v Bratislavě, nebo se vyrábí někde na okraji. Protože ty transporty dělají dost značnou část tady toho znečištění životního prostředí. A čili musím si udělat boundary, hranice, kde to je a od toho, a teď je taky samozřejmě zajímavé, jak se to dostalo kam do toho obchodního cyklu. Jestli ty velké řetězce dělají věci, které třeba ekonomicky jsou pro ně výhodné, ale ne z ochrany životního prostředí. To znamená, nechci nikoho jmenovat, ale někdo si tyto lahvičky objedná do velkoskladu, který bude v Bratislavě, a tam se to všechno svozí a potom to přesune do Košic. Protože se mu vyplatí to mět v objemu milion. Takže je to zajímavá věc a je to jako užitečná věc, ale dá to hodně práce a vyšetřování. Tak máme 12.
Děkuji pěkně za odpověď.
Někdo ještě
nějaká otázka? Ak nie, možno ešte ja by som si dovolil, možno jednu z posledných otázok. Skôr otázka, ktorá sa ľahko kladie, ale asi ťažšie sa zodpovedá. Z tej vašej prednášky a komplexnej prednášky, aj čiastočne z tých diskusných odpovedí, je vidieť, že tá ochrana životného prostredia nie je dnes pri tých technológiách a inováciách problémom technologickým, ale skôr problémom politickým, ekonomickým a možno problémom, ktorý spôsobujeme my sami, pohodlní spotrebitelia, ktorí chceme mať nové rýchle auta, zároveň úsporné, ktorí chceme mať nové mobilné technológie. Kde je podľa vás najväčší potenciál začať ten proces toho udržateľného života alebo ochrany životného prostredia? Má to byť politické, má to byť ekonomické, ale tá zmena má byť práve od nás, od spotrebiteľov. A ak áno, v ktorej oblasti vy ako odborník by ste nám odporúčal začať?
No, to je velice dobrá otázka a já jsem nějakou dobu pracoval v Manchesteru v Tyndall Center for Research in Environmental Change. A když jsem tam přišel, tak jsem byl překvapený, protože jako inženýr jsem čekal, že tam budou sami technologové a více jak polovina byli netechnologové. A byli tam lidé z politologie, ze sociologie, z psychologie. A to je přesně to, co říkáte, tam je potřeba, aby to fungovalo. Ošetřit všechny ty stránky. A oni tam měli takové zajímavé výzkumy, jako udělat pro všechny občany nějakou typ kreditní karty, která by se vám nabila na začátku měsíce, kredity na emise. A když cokoliv koupíte, tak nejen platit, ale odebrat vám patřičný počet kreditů za benzín, za teplo, za jídlo, za šaty. No a teď přišli k tomu, co když 20. už to budete mít vyčerpané. Tak říkali, no tak z hlediska psychologie je nejlepší najít si bezdomovce a koupit to od něho. Což mně připadalo takové divné, ale svým způsobem možná, ale ta společnost nebo akceptovat, limitovat tady ten dopad na životního prostředí a když budu žít příliš rozmařile, tak si to musím koupit od někoho jiného, čili zahrnout do toho ekonomii. A abych řekl pravdu, z té hlediska sociologie a psychologie jediná možnost je přesvědčovat a vychovávat. A o politicích jsem mluvil, a jsou zelení, ale já tady v tomto dělám spoustu let a nikdy nikdo ze strany zelených nepřišel se zeptat, jak by se snížily stopy, jak by se snížila uhlíková stopa nebo emise nebo cokoliv takového. Demonstrovat proti něčemu, to ano, a nebo to negovat. V Británii tam demonstrovali proti obchvatu měst, což je hrůza. Plzeň je typická ukázka, kde lidé trpí provozem a takzvaní zelení si tam nakoupí pozemky, nebo v Anglii se zakopali do země, nebo seděli na stromech. Čili asi z hlediska politického, kdyby vznikla opravdová zelená strana, která by měla ty nejčistší úmysly, tak by to bylo dobré. Ale z hlediska to, co existuje dneska, to nejsou příliš zelené strany. Až to jde k tomu, čemu se říká ekoteroristé, kteří negují cokoliv. A čili pokrok by měl být, že by všechny tyto specializace se daly dohromady, jak v tom Tyndall Center, a snažili se najít něčeho, jak přesvědčit lidstvo, že aby jsme méně plýtvali a lépe žili. A mnoho toho se pomalu stává i jakýmsi standardem. Energy passive houses, domy, které potřebují minimum energie. Což není špatné, to je výborné, když se dostane móda. Když se dostane móda, tak ti, kteří na to mají, tak si to rádi dopřejí. Bohužel třeba v těch automobilech je poslední móda čtyřkolky, čím větší, tím horší. A z hlediska pokroku, tam vidím, nevím, jestli se to stane, ale bylo by to báječné, kdyby jsme měli elektrické autonomní automobily. Což je předpověď, že se to může stát, a pak bychom nemuseli mít vlastní automobily. Aplikací si teďka tady naťuknu, že za 10 minut budu potřebovat odsud odjet a přijede mě autonomní automobil a zaveze mě někam. A první krok k tomu je Uber. Teď jsem byl v Manchesteru, potřeboval jsem taxi na letiště 6 hodin ráno v neděli. Tak jsem si klepl na aplikaci, tam se mě objevili, kde jsou, znáte, co je Uber. To jsou sdílení automobilů. Taxikáři to hrozně nemají rádi. A objevili se mě, kde jsou, tak jsem ťukl na jeden a za 4 hodiny, kde jsem to potřeboval, přijal. Na letiště mě to stalo 7 liber oproti normálním 27. A toto by mohly být třeba ty autonomní automobily. A kdyby se to podařilo, že lidé by neměli zájem mimo nějakých těch, kteří jsou posedlí automobilismem, ti, kteří to potřebují dopravní prostředek, nemít automobil vlastní. Byl ohromný pokrok v životní pohodě. Parkovací místa, garáže, z hlediska footprint, tam je ocel, tam je plastu, tam je všeho. To moje auto, jak často jezdí? Když jsem někde pryč, tak, ale i když jsem doma, tak ho používám hodinu denně. Takže toto je velice dobrá otázka a jedině, když všechny profese na to budou spolupracovat a největší naděj mám z toho, když by se dostala móda. Takže to, co se stane móda, tak většina lidí bere. A když bychom přesvědčili obyvatelstvo, že móda je šetřit energii a snižovat emise, tak by to bylo báječné. A daněmi, nařízeními, aspoň teda nevím, jak na Slovensku, ale v Česku, znáte ten vtip o českém národě, když chci, aby všichni odešli tímto východem, tak řeknu, tím východem nikdo nesmí odejít, všichni tam půjdou. Takže spolupráce a snažit se to udělat tak, aby to bylo atraktivní.
Děkuji pěkně za odpověď. Už nie je žiadna otázka, aby som veľmi pekne poďakoval Hodine Technickej univerzity publiku a určite aj pánu profesorovi za túto prednášku a možno za taký motiv nášmu ďalšiemu udržateľnejšiemu správaniu. Ďakujem pekne. Ďakujem.